Welcome back to the morning show here on Arise News. It's now time to take a look at news stories making headlines around the globe. Here in Nigeria, the Minister for State for Petroleum Resources, Timi Pray-Silver, said the federal government is working to make fuel available at 97 naira per litre using the compressed natural gas, CNG, as an option to Premium Motor Spirit, PMS. In Abuja on Thursday, he said the common man would not notice the subsidy on PMS has been removed when they have CNG as an option. He is partly quoted as saying, "We are thinking of giving the masses an alternative. Today, we're all hooked on PMS. What we want to do going forward is to see that we are able to move the masses to CNG gas," end quote. The minister also said he's hoping that the Petroleum Industry Bill, PIB, will be passed by the National Assembly before May. So there's a lot of good news here. CNG is cheaper than PMS, and it has other benefits, such as environmental benefits. We can all see the wildfires in Australia, and that should really awaken all of us to the reality of climate change. We cannot continue with these toxic emissions willy-nilly. And CNG, compared to PMS, you have 80% less carbon monoxide emissions, 40% less dangerous hydrocarbons being emitted. So it's the environmentally friendly option. It's cost effective. It's kinder to engines by all accounts. It's great news. And also that little allusion there to the common man will not notice when we remove fuel subsidy. Is it finally going to happen? Do we dare to hope? And also PIB, which has been, you know, hanging in the balance for years and years and years. May is just around the corner. And he also went on to say that it will coincide with the first anniversary of the second term of the Buhari government. So it looks like there's real traction. It's all rather exciting.
It is, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, one, on the petroleum industry bill, which has been on the table for many years, and the successive legislatures, you know, not been able to deal with it. The indication that this year that the petroleum industry bill will eventually be passed and become law is something to be glad about. However, the Minister of State himself is not so sure. He's just expressing hope. And he's basing that hope, that optimism, on what he calls the very good relationship between the executive and the legislature. That's between the executive and the National Assembly. And indeed, Senator Ahmad Lawan, at the close of last year, when he was talking about the plans for 2020, had said, had listed among the bills that the National Assembly will work on expeditiously, the petroleum industry bill. And also he talked about the Electoral Act Amendment reform bill. However, the other part of it, I have an issue with that. The use of natural gas, yes, for reasons of less combustion and environmental advantages. It's been used in parts of the world, in the United States, in North America, and also in countries like India, in Pakistan, you know, in parts of the Philippines. But there are issues involved, you know, because one, the vehicles that will use this, in most of the places where natural gas is used, is usually used by trucks. And then, of course, you will need to modify, vehicles or, you know, specially or specifically made vehicles. Now, how many common men in Nigeria have access to those modified vehicles? There's also the issue of storage, you know, as different from storing petrol. How do you store compressed natural gas? Do we have the facility in Nigeria? Do we even have, you know, the facility for decompression at this moment? Because what the Minister of State has done is to raise the hopes of the common man. It's not as if he has put a date to it. And I don't think that such an important issue that may point to policy is something that, you know, government officials should just say pronounce upon so casually. Was he giving us an idea about state policy that has been thought through, you know, that has been assessed in terms of Nigeria's readiness? And if you look at the existing regime, you know, why is it that the NNPC under Mele Kyari, who had given us a roadmap under his own administration, never at any point talked about this? So is this the personal idea of the Minister of State for Petroleum Resources? Such important things that can raise people's expectations and that can affect how we organize our lives, you know, it's not something that should be pronounced in such a casual manner. What Nigerians expect is that the inefficiency, to start with, you know, in the oil and gas sector, and particularly in the downstream sector, will be addressed. Two, we expect that the promise by the NNPC chair, GMT, that the refineries would be back on stream, that NNPC will get them working. We expect to see progress in that regard. We have not seen it. We need greater transparency and accountability, particularly in the downstream sector and also maybe in the upstream sector. We are not seeing that. So just to come up with one phrase, we are going to reduce pump price of fuel, and you may not notice. I think it's a bit glib for me.
You've just put a dampener.
I know, right?
On my excitement.
I was like, what do I say now? Honestly, you know, but one would hope that he didn't just come out and say this, you know. One would hope that he did come out and say this with some sort of policy backing, some sort of thinking through coming out to
not
say.
Not so fast. One would Attorney hope. General is going to come out and say, that's actually unlawful what you said.
So, yeah. Very true. Let me be careful. But, you know, there are a lot of benefits, like you said, to CNG. So it would be good to see the introduction coming into Nigeria, being used for the masses as an alternative for the masses in Nigeria. Of course, there are limitations as well, like you pointed out in a very dampening way.
I thought that the CNG engines do exist, but then you can still use CNG with regular engines. This is what I thought.
Well, I mean, the compressed natural gas is supposed to be an alternative, you know, to gasoline. But even in that case, you still have to modify, do some modifications.
So even the regular engines.
Yes.
But it also
and then do we have gas stations that can, you know, store compressed natural gas? You know, because it has to be stored, it has to be dispensed. Still, you know, do we have the facilities in place? If it is something that government is thinking about, yes. Well, when you engage the public, you should be at a point where you are almost ready. We can't keep waiting for compressed natural gas when we still have urgent issues that we can deal with to improve the current situation with the supply of gasoline. Don't forget, the other time when somebody brought up the idea of the electric car, everybody shouted him down.
Yes, I recall that. But I think we can walk and chew gum at the same time. The world is moving away from PMS, or
exactly.
We ought to be. Any kind of fossil fuel, we've seen the devastating
results.
Fourth
industrial revolution.
Yeah, so we need to move on from that. And moving on, the West African Monetary Zone, WAMZ, Convergence Council has expressed concern over the recent decision of Ivorian President Mr. Alassane Ouattara to unilaterally rename the CFA franc as ECO this year. Rising from a meeting of ministers of finance and governors of the central banks of the WAMZ on the ECOWAS single currency program, the council also recommended that an extraordinary summit of the authority of heads of state and government of the WAMZ member states be convened soon to discuss the matter and other related issues. Nigeria's Minister of Finance, Budget and National Planning, Mrs. Zainab Ahmed, who read the council's communique issued at the end of its deliberations in Abuja, described the actions of Ouattara, who is the chairman of the authority of the heads of state and government of West African Economic and Monetary Union, as not in line with the decision of the authority of heads of state and government of ECOWAS for the adoption of the ECO as the name of an independent ECOWAS single currency.
WAMS Convergence Council wishes to emphasize that this action is not in line with the decisions of the authority of the heads of state and government of ECOWAS for the adoption of the ECO as the name of an independent ECOWAS single currency. The WAMS Convergence Council recommends that an extraordinary summit of the authority of the heads of state and governments of the WAMS member states be convened soon to discuss this matter and other related issues.
The issue here is that it's this kind of unilateral appropriation of a name that was agreed for the, you know, single currency for the entire ECOWAS zone should not just be appropriated by the Francophone countries, and that's correct. I mean, what then happens to the ECO if they now turn that to the CFA? Should ECOWAS then go back to the drawing board and find another name for their single currency? Of course not.
Absolutely.
Anyway, let's take a short commercial break. When we return, the conversation will continue. You're still watching The Money Show. Here on Arise News. Welcome back to the morning show here on Arise News. Now, before we went on break, we were talking about the decision of the West African Monetary Zone Convergence Council to condemn the action that was taken by seven Francophone countries and Guinea-Bissau. Guinea-Bissau was the only non-Francophone country that was part of that economic and monetary union that decided on ECO unilaterally. And I think that the condemnation by the Convergence Council is in order, because what was done by Cote d'Ivoire and the other countries, went ahead of the decision that was taken at the July 2019 meeting of the heads of ECOWAS states and governments. What was decided there was a consensus on a single currency, on a single monetary union among the various West African states. And the heads of states and governments were supposed to meet later and then decide and work out the modalities. But it was like the Francophone countries and Guinea-Bissau just went ahead and made the announcement. And that raised a lot of suspicion about, some form of neocolonialism or economic imperialism, being engineered in the background by France. And it didn't help the matter that the name of the French president was mentioned in association with that announcement. So it will amount to an outsider, more or less hijacking an initiative and imposing details that have not been properly worked out. And so this Convergence Council at a meeting in Abuja has now recommended that there should be an extraordinary general meeting of the heads of states, ECOWAS heads of states and governments, where the decision that was taken in July 2019 can now be properly put before the table, and there will be, consensus rather than just a group of eight going on their own to make their own announcement. And I think that is in order, but I would like to see how, Cote d'Ivoire and those other countries would react. And what this has done is to validate the position of Nigeria at the time, when Nigeria decided that it would be studying the situation. And I'm sure Ghana, that showed interest in it, later more or less modified its position in line with the position of Nigeria. And then what comes across, of course, is that this West African Monetary Zone Convergence Council, the meeting was attended majorly by the Anglophone countries. So at the bottom of all this is this rivalry between Anglophone West Africa and Francophone West Africa. But it will be interesting to see how all of that plays out.
It certainly does seem that way, but there is that underlying tone of neocolonialism that you can't get rid of when you're looking at this situation. The influence of France cannot go unquestioned when we're speaking about this particular matter at hand. But what's interesting to see here is that it definitely cannot be expected that the ECHO is going to be taken away from its initial use or its initial proposed use, and what, ECOWAS is expected to then go back to the drawing board and think of a new name? It certainly cannot work that way. So it will be interesting to see how this plays out. It does seem like there is some rivalry here, but the one thing that I am smelling the most is definitely neocolonialism. That's all I'll say. Anyway, we will head over now to see what's going on in the sports news today with Aaron. Good morning. How are you doing?
Good morning. Happy Friday. Doctor?
Yeah, thank God it's Friday.
Thank God it's Friday, they usually say. And quite a lot has been happening in the world of sports, and we usually take our time to celebrate the women, because in Nigeria, in sports more importantly, the women are way ahead of the men when it comes to individual sporting events and how they've actually distinguished themselves. Even in group events, the women have actually done better than men. And the latest being Odunayo Adukoroye, all right, the 26-year-old Ondo State wrestler. She actually was in an event just yesterday and brought back gold. And that meant that she's the only lady from the wrestling category going into the Olympics that has qualified. And you look at this and you say to yourself, this lady has been on the trajectory since 2010, when she actually broke onto the scene, on the local scene. And when she started attending games, the Olympics in 2014, the Commonwealth Games, she's been winning and raking in medals, All African Games. And as it stands right now, in the 53 kg category, going to the Olympics, she looks like the most assured person that will deliver Nigerians maybe, only gold. We are hoping that every other federations come to light, but as it stands right now, she looks like the only person that will deliver gold for Nigeria based on what she has done, based on proper preparations for the Olympics. She's been doing fantastic.
Well, I mean, congratulations to her on her achievement yesterday. Yes. As you said, she's our major hope for a medal at the Tokyo Olympics.
Yes.
Well, as you said, you know, she's been quite distinguished. She won the gold in the Commonwealth Games in 2014. Mm-hmm. She won another gold in 2016.
Yeah.
And at the last Olympics, she went as far as the round of 16.
Yes.
Before she crashed out. But since then, she, you know, her rating has improved.
Massive.
She's a freestyle wrestler, and in the 57 kg category, she's rated number 3 in the world
right now,
which is quite impressive. The other person in that category is Blessing Odorodudu, who is rated number 7 in the world. But what we should be asking for is for sponsorship for her. You know, many of these athletes, even when they excel like that, they don't get enough sponsorship, and they don't get enough support from the Nigerian government. If indeed we all agree that, you know, Odunayo Adekoroye is likely to win a medal, I think every support that she may need from the Nigerian authorities should be provided. We shouldn't wait for her to excel on her own steam, and then we turn around and we say, oh, she's a Nigerian. She's from Ilututu, you know, Kitukupa local government of Ondo State.
Since you mentioned that, it's good that, since you mentioned that, it's good we say this. The minister of the new minister of youth and sport, Sunday Dare, should be commended, because we spoke about the initiative of him bringing in Adopt an Athlete initiative, whereby he brought the private sector to adopt an athlete and try to form them.
That's a great idea.
Yes, and just yesterday, Halogen Securities, I don't know if the announcement came alongside, or maybe they knew, because they actually announced that they have signed a partnership with the lady.
Amazing.
And they were going to be giving her the $5,000 that will be needed, because local athletes get $5,000, foreign-based athletes get $20,000. But as it stands right now, I will still admonish anyone out there, because since she's the brightest light going to the Olympics, we know some people that have been highly rated. We know some people that have been hyped going to the Olympics that are foreign-based athletes, that every single time they get to the Olympics, they find a way to just probably bungle themselves or actually cave in. Odunayo should be getting not just the $5,000 that is needed to probably push a local athlete. She should be getting as much as the $20,000, because I must commend the president of the Nigerian Wrestling Federation, Honorable Daniel Igali. Over the years, they've spent money sending her to major international tournaments time and time again. She's distinguished herself not once, not twice. The major tournament for wrestling in Paris that was attended last year, she came in second, won Nigeria's first gold medal. And you look at that and you say to yourself, this lady needs all the support.
And she won bronze.
She's a good investment.
And she won bronze at the senior wrestling championship.
Yes.
In Kazakhstan.
Yes.
So you look, last year.
So you look at all this and you say to yourself, this lady, we are hoping that she gets more support. And if she gets this support, we know she will do well. Hopefully. All things
will
be equal.
She will.
But we'll still be monitoring our situation. Mm-hmm. And let's also tell you that this man has been in the news, Anthony Joshua, has found himself in what they call the cul-de-sac. And when you become a very successful man, you will be literally tied up for fights as a boxer. And Anthony Joshua right now has two contenders, mandatory contenders, in the boxing categories for the IBF and the IBO. Kubrapolev yesterday tweeted that he is going to be fighting Anthony Joshua sometime in March. In March, then the other one, the WBO, all right, which Alexander Usyk is in May. So these two fights are neck and neck. They are mandatory fights because of the belts. And Anthony Joshua, his sights are not set on Kubrapolev or Alexander Usyk. He's rather thinking of what will happen. He's hoping to see what will happen on the 22nd of February when Deontay Wilder goes against Tyson Fury. So he's looking at both of those fighters and saying, the fighter that emerges the winner, I will likely take on. But unfortunately for him, he has been tied by these belts. And some pundits have told him the wise thing to do is give up these belts. The world wants to see and Anthony Joshua, who they claim is the greatest boxer as we speak on earth, go against either maybe the best of Tyson Fury or the best of Deontay Wilder. Give up those belts, prepare yourself, put yourself in the right frame of mind, and not get distracted, because it was a distraction that brought about the loss to Ruiz Jr. last year. Let's see what actually happened.
You recall that, you know, after his last fight,
yes,
Anthony Joshua was given 180 days within which he would defend his title, or, you know, a deadline of up till June 2020. Mm. And the person that was chosen was the Ukrainian, as the Alexander Usyk.
Yes.
But then, of course, he and Pulev were supposed to have encountered each other in 2017. Mm. But Pulev then had an injury. So for some reason, because Alexander and Pulev are in pole position, that is why he's likely to fight Pulev first. And that seems to have been confirmed. The Anthony Joshua camp has not denied it. What has not been established is where the fight will take place.
Yes.
Pulev himself, in the poster that he put out, has announced a venue in Turkey,
yeah,
in Istanbul. But, you know, that has raised some eyebrows in England, because that will be the third time, if it happens in Istanbul, that Anthony Joshua will be fighting outside. He fought Andy Ruiz in New York, and then he got his belt back in Saudi Arabia. Mm. So, you know, the expectation will have been that this would take place in London, either at the Tottenham Sports New Stadium or at Wembley Stadium.
Yeah.
That's where the controversy is. But Eddie Hearn's, his coach, has not yet said anything. As for Tyson Fury and Anthony Wilder,
yeah,
there's no doubt that one of these days he will have to meet one of them. I thought Tyson Fury, he said he wanted to be Tyson Fury's sparring partner.
That,
you know, but do you think that will happen?
I don't think so, because if you do that, if Tyson Fury now wins, whoever comes out tops in the sparring sessions, we'll always claim we'll have the psychological
public. Will it be public?
They would have, at some point, they would have to make it public. These are the biggest boxers in the world, going toe-to-toe in a friendly bout.
Thank you.
So to speak. Let's see what actually will be happening to these guys.
Thank you very much.
Have a good weekend.
Thank you.